Greetings to the president, greetings to the commissars, greetings to the fighters, fighters in South Africa, fighters in the continent and fighters in the diaspora. My name is Marshal Dlamini. I'm the Secretary General of the Economic Freedom Fighters. Today we are going to make a presentation on the organizational character and the organizational redesign as they were adopted by our second National People's Assembly. So our presentation is going to cover various topics. The first one is going to be what is the EFF? We're going to look at the foundations of our organization, the history of our organization. Then we're going to look at the manifestations of the EFF. You'd remember that as an organization, we manifest in different forms, like other organizations, like other political parties that were involved in the anti-colonial struggles. They manifested themselves in different forms. Others were underground movements, others were liberation movements, others were civil rights organizations. Now, the EFF manifests itself in different formations as well. So we're going to deal with the organizational manifestation. We'll look at the ideological and the political manifestation. We'll deal with the campaign and the mass movement manifestation, government manifestation, and then we'll look at the pan-Africanist manifestation. Also, we're going to deal with the simple diagnosis on the current state of the EFF. Where are we as the organization? And then we look at what is the ideal organization? What becomes the dream of the EFF? What do we seek to achieve with this organization? We look at what defines the central command team, what should define the province of the EFF, what should define the region of the EFF, what should define the branch of the EFF. And then lastly, we look at what is to be done to make sure that we've got an organization that can live for generations and generations after us. And then we'll deal with a few constitutional amendments that were adopted by the Second National People's Assembly. Finally, we'll look at the principles of the EFF. But let's start with the basics. What is the EFF? The EFF is a socialist and a pan-Africanist political party that was founded in 2013. The reason for the formation of the EFF is that thousands of activists and millions of people of South Africa, they learn to appreciate and accept that the political power, the political freedom that was gained by this country in 1994 did not bring in the economic freedom as it was expected by millions of South Africans. The reality is that in South Africa, the political apartheid, it ended in 1994, but the economic apartheid, it still exists up to date, it's still intact. Those who owned our land, who owned our mineral resources, who owned our economy before 1994, up to today, they are still in charge of our land, they are still in charge of our economy, they are still in charge of our resources. So the EFF was founded as a political party for the working class. It must be a party that wins political power. It must transform the state. It must transform the society for the benefit of all. And as an organization, we agree that political power without economic power is meaningless. For people to have their political freedom when they do not participate in the economy of their country is just a waste of time. So if we look now at our organizational manifestation, our founding manifesto of the EFF, which was adopted on that historic National Assembly on what is to be done, defines the EFF as follows. The EFF is a radical and a militant economic emancipation movement. It brings together revolutionary, fearless, radical and militant activists. It brings together workers' movement, community-based organizations, non-governmental organizations and lobby groups under the umbrella in pursuit for the struggle for economic emancipation. But despite bringing all these different streams together, the EFF is a membership-based organization. What do we mean by that? We mean that each and every person who joins the EFF as an individual. There's no joining of the EFF through a sector. Also, there's no member of the EFF that joins the EFF with a different group, or we say it's a sector, or it's a trade union. All members of the EFF, they join as individuals, and they must join the EFF at a branch level. There is no member of the EFF that can join the organization at a regional level, that can join at a provincial level, that can even join at a national level, or even on social media. You can't join the EFF on social media. So if you are a fighter, that says, no, I joined the organization on social media. We are calling on you fighters to say, go to your branch. That's where our constitution tells us to join the EFF. We join at a branch level. So don't be a fighter that is always that joined the EFF on social media. Now, the establishment of the structures of the EFF. Our constitution establishes structures of the EFF under the principle of democratic centralism. We'll deal in detail and later with the explanation or the definition of our understanding of democratic centralism as the EFF when we are dealing with the principles of the organization. But now, for now, let us look at the structures of the EFF. We start with the lowest level in terms of our structures, the Branch People's Assembly. It is an assembly of the EFF that has been convened at a branch level. When at a specific ward, 100 and a minimum of 100 members of the EFF have joined the organization, the EFF convenes what we call a Branch People's Assembly. That assembly of the EFF at a ward level or at a branch level, it sits and then it elects leadership. Also, it determines the program of action of the EFF at the ward level. So all our wards are as per the demarcation by the Municipal Demarcation Board. So it elects leadership. The leadership is called the Branch Command Team. And the lifespan of the Branch Command Team, their term of office is only 2 years at the office. Now let's move to the region where we have an assembly called the Regional People's Assembly. This assembly is an assembly of the EFF at the regional level. It is convened once. 90% of the branches at a specific region have gone through their launch and their branches in good standing. So it is an assembly that is convened by members, and it must be gender-based, meaning that the delegates that come from different branches that are attending the National Assembly, they must be gender-based, meaning there must be a male and a female representative. If we cannot get a male and a female representative, it means it can only be two females, but it can never be two male representatives coming from a branch to come and be part of the Regional Assembly. Why we say that is because of the EFF's commitment to gender balance. It's because of the EFF's commitment to gender struggles. Now, this assembly also elect the leadership of the EFF at a regional level. And that leadership is called the Regional Command Team. And it has a term of office of 3 years as well. The same assembly, it receives reports in the form of a political report, in the form of an organizational report, and the treasurer's report. Now let's look at the Provincial People's Assembly. But before we do that, it's important to know that the EFF has got 53 offices in all regions of South Africa. And these offices, they provide administrative support to all our members and branches at the regional level. So members and branches of the EFF for administrative support, they go to our regional offices, which are all over the country in all the 53 regions. And they are operating every Monday to Friday from 8 o'clock until 4. Now let's look at the Provincial People's Assembly. This is an assembly of the EFF at the provincial level. It is convened only after once all the Regional People's Assembly have gone to their conferences. And 90% of the branches are in good standing of that specific province. Also, it must be gender balance in terms of the delegates that are attending that assembly. It also elects leadership with a term of office of 4 years. It receives reports in terms of a political report, organizational report, and the treasurer's report. The full constitution of the provincial leadership that we call the Provincial Command Team, it is the 25 directly elected fighters led by their chairperson, the deputy chairperson, the secretary, the deputy secretary, the treasurer, the 20 additional fighters, plus the regional chairpersons and regional secretaries. So all of them combined, they form the leadership of the EFF at a provincial level that we call it a Provincial Command Team. Now, finally, let's look at the National Assembly. The National Assembly The National People's Assembly is the highest decision-making body of the EFF. It is the only assembly that can adopt and that can amend and adopt the constitution of the EFF. It is the only assembly that can amend and adopt the policies of the EFF. It is the only assembly that elects the central command team of the EFF. The national leadership of the EFF is only elected at the National People's Assembly. The national leadership of the EFF is called the central command team, and it's constituted by the officials led by the president and the commander-in-chief, the deputy president, the secretary general, the deputy secretary general, the national chairperson, the treasurer general, plus the 40 additional commissars that get directly elected by the National People's Assembly. So the full composition of the CCT, the Central Command Team, it's 45 commissars led by the officials. It's a president and the secretary of the Women and the Youth Command. It's the provincial chairpersons and the provincial secretaries. They all form part of the Central Command Team. The president and the secretary of the EFF Student Command, they form part of the Central Command Team, but they don't have voting rights. So the Central Command Team, it meets quarterly to receive reports from regions and provinces, and then it determines the next course of action. Now, our constitution requires that at its first sitting, the CCT, the newly elected CCT, it must elect the War Council. The War Council is constituted of officials plus 13 members of the CCT. The EFF, the War Council is responsible for the day-to-day running of the EFF. Now, let us deal with the ideological and the political manifestation of the EFF. The EFF is the only progressive political party in South Africa and possibly in the entire continent. The ideological perspective of the EFF is outlined in our founding manifesto. So it is important for us fighters and commissars that we read, we understand, and we internalize our founding manifesto, because it gives the ideological perspective of the EFF. It also, our founding manifesto also deals with the historical challenges of the oppressed people of the continent. It also outlines what becomes the next course of action for the oppressed and the conquered people of South Africa and the people of the continent. Our founding manifesto also defines the EFF as follows. It is a leftist, it is a radical leftist, anti-capitalist, anti-imperialist movement anchored by grassroots formations and struggles. It is the vanguard of workers and community struggles, and it will always be on the side of the people. The EFF, with determination and consistency, will associate with the protest movements, and it will always join the struggle that defy unjust laws. That is the definition of the EFF by our founding manifesto. Now, as we proceed, also our founding manifesto also says the EFF draws its inspiration from the Marxist, Leninist, and Fanonian schools of thought in their analysis of state, culture, imperialism, and class contradictions in society. Now, what do we learn from Marx? What we learn from Marx as the EFF is the philosophy of materialism. We also learn the understanding of the political economy, and we also learn about scientific socialism. And then Lenin, we learn about the theory of organizations, and we learn about the practice of socialism. And then from Fanon, what do we learn? We learn about the nature and the character of colonization, and also we learn about the reality of racism, especially here in the African continent. But our book, The Coming Revolution, that was published in 2014, says that the Marxist and Leninist tools of analysis and guides into action, they dictate that as a movement, the EFF is fighting for socialism. So there must never be any contradiction on what we are fighting for. We are fighting for socialism on the basis that we are using the Marxist, Leninist, and Fanonian schools of analysis as our tools of analysis and guides to action. The aim of the EFF is to defeat the racial capitalism that began under colonialism in South Africa, and it was consolidated and continued under the apartheid regime. Now, as an anti-capitalist and anti-imperialist movement, we need to understand the nature of South Africa's capitalism in order that we understand what kind of an animal that we are dealing with in our struggle for socialism. Also, our book, The Coming Revolution, also cautions us and says that if we replace the Marxist and the Leninist and the Fanonian schools of thought as our tools of analysis and guide into action, if we replace them, it will lead or will subject our organization to be directionless. It will be an organization that is only obsessed with winning political power or without knowing what to do with it, with winning political power without transforming society, without redistribution of wealth for the benefit of the people of South Africa. As we have seen with the current ruling party, that they went to win the political power, but they don't know what to do with it. As our people, they remain landless. Our people, they remain unemployed. Our founding manifesto now, it deals with the non-negotiable cardinal pillars as the policies of the EFF, but also as the only glue that holds the EFF together. So the cardinal pillars, before anything else, they are the only clue that holds the EFF together. And we'll go through these cardinal pillars. The first cardinal pillar is the expropriation of South Africa's land without compensation for equal redistribution in use. The second cardinal pillar is the nationalization of mines, banks, and other strategic sectors of the economy without compensation. Cardinal pillar number three is building state and government capacity with an intention to abolish tenders. Cardinal pillar number four is free quality education, healthcare, housing, and sanitation. Cardinal pillar number five is massive protected industrial development to create millions of sustainable jobs and to close the wage gaps. Introduction of minimum wage to close the apartheid wage gap and to promote the rapid career growth of Africans in their workplaces. And then cardinal pillar number six is the development of the African economy and a move from reconciliation to justice. And lastly, cardinal pillar number seven, it says we demand open, accountable, and corrupt-free government without fear of victimization by the state agencies. So fighters, all of us, fighters, members, supporters of the EFF, the ideas that we have, any contribution that we have, it must be for the attainment of these seven cardinal pillars, because it's only through the attainment of these seven cardinal pillars that the EFF will be able to achieve its strategic mission. And the strategic mission of the EFF is economic freedom in our lifetime. But also, our founding manifesto clearly defines who are the motive forces of the EFF, who stands to benefit in this organization, who stands to benefit by the existence of the EFF. It's important to pay attention to this, because if we don't pay attention, we're going to subject this organization to be directionless. It's going to be an amoeba of an organization that it doesn't know what it stands for. Like what is happening with the current ruling party. One day it represents the Western nations, the people of America, the people of United Kingdom. The following day, it represents the Asian communities. That is why, if you look at the Chinese here in South Africa, they are classified as BEE. They are given the same status as black people of South Africa. The other day, it represents the beneficiaries of the apartheid regime. That is why you saw in parliament, the ANC was ready to kill in defense of the murderers de Klerk. On the other day, it represents themselves as the cadres. That is why when they don't find expression through either in the corridors of the government, or their views don't find expressions and their interest in their structures as the organization, the only thing they resort to is to killing each other. Simply because they don't know who they represent, they don't know who stands to benefit by the existence of their party. So our founding manifesto clearly defines who are the motive forces of the EFF, who stands to benefit. And it says it's a working class, people of South Africa who do not control the means of production. It says it's a landless masses of our people, the homeless masses of our people, the unemployed and underemployed masses of our people, the discriminated and undermined professionals, the black professionals, the youth of South Africa that remains unemployed, the informal settlement dwellers, the rural and the urban poor. Why I'm making an emphasis on these fighters is that during the time of confusion and frustrations, when our views or our own personal interests don't find expression in the structures of the EFF, before and we think that our only recourse is to call for the destruction of the EFF, is to go and badmouth and damage the image of the EFF, it is important that we go back to our founding manifesto and read especially this part that says who are the motive forces of our revolution. Because the motive forces of our revolution, as I've taken you through them, it doesn't say the EFF was founded for the benefit of its leaders. It doesn't say the EFF was founded so that its members can benefit. So before you destroy the EFF because your interest, they did not find expression, you must know that you're not just only destroying the EFF, but you are destroying the only weapon in the hands of mine workers, the only weapon in the hands of farm workers, the only weapon in the hands of domestic workers, security guards, and petrol attendants. That is why when you look at our victories in the city of Johannesburg and in the city of Tshwane, where we went to table a motion that was adopted by those councils, where we said the workers of those municipalities, they must be insourced, the cleaners and the security guards. There was never a meeting of the EFF or the leadership of the EFF calling those beneficiaries, calling those workers and saying to them, now that we've submitted a motion that has been adopted by the council, now that you have been employed here permanently instead of working through labor brokers, now that you are getting benefits, medical aid and pension, you are forced to join the EFF. That never happened because the founding manifesto of the EFF dealt with that question to say who are the motive forces of our revolution. So that is why there was no need for leadership to go and put pressure on those workers to say, now that the EFF has taken your side, the EFF has resolved your frustrations with your employer, now you must join the EFF. It's up to them, it's their individual choice. The EFF was doing exactly what our founding manifesto prescribes that it must do. Now, fighters, let us look at the campaign and the mass movement manifestation. The EFF is also an activist campaign and a mass movement organization. What do we mean by that is that we're not only focusing on winning or contesting political power, we also get involved in the struggles of our people on a daily basis. That is why we are saying the EFF is the vanguard of communities and workers' struggles. So we get involved on their daily struggles without just only focusing on winning the political power. When it comes to the issues of land, the EFF joins our people in their struggles on the issues of land. We have been involved in struggles where our people, they've been evicted from their homes, they've been forcefully removed from their land. We have taken those cases. Some of them we've gone as far as going to court in defense of our communities, in defense of our people, because it is our commitment, it is one of the principles of the EFF that will always be on the side of the people. When it comes to the issues of free education, you would know that the EFF Student Command, they were in the front lines, they were leading the Fees Must Fall protests in demand for free education in South Africa. You would know that each and every year, at the beginning of the year, without fail, the EFF Student Command, they lead a campaign on all the universities called Sizofunda Ngenkani campaign, where they are found at the gates of each and every university to assist the young people who want to register at the universities, but also to make sure that there is no deserving young person who gets excluded in the universities on the basis that they cannot afford to pay fees. When it comes to the issues of healthcare, you would know that 2018, was declared the year of the healthcare by the EFF, where all our branches, regions, provinces, including at national level, we took the campaigns to bring awareness about the state of the healthcare in South Africa. We know that our healthcare in South Africa has collapsed. Everything that we inherited from the apartheid regime has not been managed. We've not built new hospitals. So our people, when they go to our hospitals today, they just go in there to die. So we have been involved in those struggles, the struggles of insourcing. We have recorded victories in the city of Johannesburg, in the city of Tshwane, as I alluded to earlier, that the workers and the security guards in the city of Joburg and the city of Tshwane, in their thousands, they have been now insourced and they are employed permanently, as previously they were employed either through labor brokers or through tender people. Now they are employed permanently, getting decent wages, getting necessary benefits, pension funds, and medical aid. That has been part of the struggles that the EFF was leading in front and made sure that we submitted those motions, and those motions were adopted by those councils. But also we recorded victories for the workers of Vets University and the workers at UNISA, where we demanded that those workers, they must be insourced. When it comes to the issue of the struggles of fights against xenophobia, the EFF is in the forefront again of making sure that our people in our communities, where we see tendencies of discriminating against our brothers and sisters from the continent, the EFF is always involved in those struggles and it always defends our brothers, because we are committed to the ideals of the founding father of Pan-Africanism, Dr. Kwame Nkrumah, when he visioned that we must have a united Africa, the unity of the sovereign state of Africa, with one president, with one currency, with one state of United States of Africa. So when we see that our brothers and sisters are not being treated in a proper way in our communities, the EFF gets involved. Now, let us look at the Pan-Africanist manifestation of the EFF. As I said earlier on, the EFF is also a Pan-Africanist organization that believes and work hard for the ideals of the unity of the African continent. We take that from the vision of all the progressive leaders that were there to say Africa must unite in order to liberate itself. Africa must unite in order that it can benefit from its own mineral wealth in this continent. So we are committed to Pan-Africanism. We are a Pan-Africanist organization. So since our inception in 2013, we have inspired different structures of the EFF that were formed all around the continent. As we speak to date, we've got EFF in Liberia, we've got EFF in Malawi, we've got EFF in Ghana, we've got EFF in Lesotho, we've got EFF in Namibia. But what is more interesting about EFF in Namibia is that they went as far as contesting elections and they managed to get two seats in the national parliament of Namibia. As we speak today, the EFF is represented in the parliament of Namibia. But the second National People's Assembly also adopted a resolution that we must associate and support the progressive movements in the African continent. But it's not just a free support. We said there are a set of values that those movements, they must comply to so that they can get the support of the EFF. And one of those values, we said, they must be committed to Pan-Africanism, which aims to integrate the African continent. They must be committed to the African agenda that is defined by the return of land, mineral resources and economy. And it must be under control of the Africans by themselves. They must be committed to human rights and gender equality. There must be no association with imperialist forces through their political programs or funding. So you can't be a friend of the EFF if you are associated with imperialist forces, either through a political program or even through funding. You must be committed to democracy and regular elections, because we have seen some tendencies in the continent where some dictators, they are refusing to accept democratic results. They are refusing to even conduct regular elections. So those were the principles that those are the principles and the values that we're going to support any African formation, any progressive formations or associations in the continent. Now let us look at the government's manifestations of the EFF. The EFF participated in the national and provincial elections in 2014, and we received about 6.35% of the voter base, or of the votes, and that led to us getting 61 public representatives in the National Assembly, the National Council of Provinces, and the provincial legislatures. And in 2016, we again participated in the local government elections, and we received 8.2% of the votes, and that led to us receiving about having representation of 827 councillors in the 221 municipalities around the country. So that was another victory that we achieved in that we recorded in 2016. Then in 2019, we also participated in the national and the provincial elections, where we received 10.2% of the votes, and then we managed to get 44 members at the National Assembly. We got 9 members or representatives in the National Council of Provinces, and then we've got 50 members in our provincial legislatures. Other victories when it comes to the governance manifestation of the EFF is that the EFF will have managed that in the national parliament, the resolution, the motion that was sponsored by the EFF regarding the amendment of section 25, it was adopted by the parliament, and the parliament agreed that a review committee must be set up that is going to look at the review and the amendment of section 25 that will allow for the expropriation of land without compensation. That process is still ongoing, and we are confident as the organization that when that committee goes to report back to parliament, that motion will be adopted. The cardinal pillar number one of the EFF will be fulfilled, where we call for the expropriation of South Africa's land without compensation for equal redistribution in use. Secondly, as I said, that we've got other different victories, various victories that we have achieved in the city of Johannesburg, in the city of Tshwane, Nelson Mandela Bay. We've got victories that we have recorded in the provincial legislatures as well. So let us now look at Fighters, the ideal organization. What is the dream? We aspire to be a pan-continental movement that has got the capacity to win elections, not only in South Africa, but in the entire continent. We wish to have an organization that has elected structures at all levels. You'd know that two of our regions in the Eastern Cape and KZN have not gone to their Regional People's Assembly. So they must go to their Regional People's Assembly so that we've got a fully functional organization. We must be an organization that owns our own offices from national level, provincial level, regional level, including branches. We must have offices at a branch level. We must be a fully functional organization. You know that our constitution requires us that we must have the EFF Women's Command and the EFF Youth Command. Until those structures have been lodged and gone to their assemblies, we are not a fully functional organization. So we must launch those structures. We must be an organization that uses informal technology and systems to communicate with the members. We must be an organization with a proper membership system that can communicate to its members. It must know their gender, it must know their race, it must know their employment status. We must be an organization with an excellent research and development capacity to guide our fighters, to guide our commissars that are deployed in different legislatures. We must be an organization with a professionalized political school that can produce graduates on various fields. We must be an organization that owns a huge portfolio of property where we can have our own conference facilities, have our own accommodation, so that we stop spending a lot of money on conference facilities and accommodation. We must be an organization with a fully and functional and efficient media and publicity division. Now let us look at the central command team. What should define the central command team? The Central Command Team should be constituted by fighters who have individual and collective capacity to lead the people of South Africa and the continent. It must be constituted by commissars who are all-rounders, who can mobilize, who can organize without seeking external capacity. It must be composed by commissars who deeply understand the constitution of the EFF, the founding manifesto of the EFF, and other policies of the EFF. It must be commissars who've got the capacity to go and conduct political education and training to our lower structures. Commissars, they must be able to travel the breadth and the length of South Africa. They must be commissars who can be deployed each and every corner of South Africa, because our work starts from the VDs, the branches, the regions, the provinces. We must be commissars who can be deployed and be dependable to go and do the work in each and every part of South Africa. As commissars, we should command absolute clarity on all issues, and we must seek to improve our knowledge and expertise on various issues that we are dealing with in society. What is the ideal province of the EFF? The ideal province of the EFF, they must have the capacity to mobilize and organize their own programs, mass rallies, without seeking assistance from the national office. Our PCT must be led by the fighters who can conduct political education to our lower structures. We must have offices that are owned and controlled by the EFF at all times, who can service our structures and our people on a daily basis. It must be, our PCT must be composed by the fighters who understand the constitution of the EFF, the founding manifesto of the EFF, and other policies of the EFF. The ideal region, what kind of a region do we want? The region that has got a full-time regional secretary and administrative staff that can assist our people and structures of the EFF on a daily basis. It must be led by fighters who understand the founding manifesto, the constitution, and other policies of the EFF. The regions, they must have the capacity to mobilize and organize their own programs without seeking assistance from the PCT or the head office. So regions, if they want to have their mass rallies in stadiums, they must have a capacity to do that without seeking any additional assistance. What is the ideal branch of the EFF, the basic unit of the EFF? It's a branch. We must have first functional PCTs with functional VD coordinating structures. The PCTs, they must be able to hold meetings of the PCT and the membership meetings of the EFF on a monthly basis, as it is required by our constitution. Our branches, they must have the capacity to mobilize or organize transport to transport our members and supporters of the EFF to mass programs of the EFF, including the mass rallies. We can't be an organization that every time when we've got a rally, the branches, they must rely on head office to pay for transport like buses and taxis. Our branches, they must have that capacity to mobilize and organize transport. Our branches, they must meet on a monthly basis to develop a program of action that talks to the issues at branch level, the issues in their communities. They must be able to formulate and come with a program of action, and they must be able to follow up on that program of action. Now, let us deal with the principles of the EFF. The principles of the EFF, we'll read them as follows. Firstly, we've got democratic centralism. Democratic centralism, it refers to a principle of democratic consultation and engagements before decisions are adopted. And once adopted, they are binding on all members and structures of the organization. The decisions of the higher structure are binding on lower structures, and the decisions of the majority are binding on the minority. When it comes to discipline and hard work, we're saying discipline in the revolution is not a side issue. It is an essential component of what EFF seeks to achieve. Without discipline and hard work, all the aspirations and the objectives of the EFF will not be achieved. Laziness in the EFF is the highest form of ill discipline. The powers of the National People's Assembly, the National People's Assembly is the highest decision-making body of the EFF. It is the only assembly that can amend and adopt the constitution and the policies of the EFF. The central command team is the highest decision-making body of the EFF in between assemblies. Now, fighters, let us all go to the ground. Let us go and work hard for this organization that is the only weapon in the hands of our poor people. The conference, the Second National People's Assembly, it gave an instruction to all of us that let's go and consolidate the ground towards socialist power. Now, fellow fighters, let us look at the constitutional amendments as they were adopted by the Second National People's Assembly. EFF membership is open to all Africans that join the EFF at branch level and abide by the constitution and the policies of the EFF. CCT reserves the right to accept or reject any person who wants to join the EFF. Members who are expelled or resigned are not allowed to join the EFF again. The CCT can recall any public representative if they do not fulfill their task in their respective deployments. The EFF must convene a mid-term assembly called the National General Assembly to receive the progress reports on the resolutions that were taken from the last National People's Assembly. The CCT has increased from 35 to 40 additional members. The PCT has increased from 21 to 25 members. The RCT has increased from 15 to 21 members. Now, fighters, finally, let us look at the most important component of the revolution, a fighter. A fighter is a ground force that knows their community. They are the first ones to arrive either at a wedding, funeral, or in the time of disaster in their communities. A fighter knows their communities, including the number of people that reside in their wards. A fighter must be an agitator who moves the crowds towards the revolutionary action. A fighter must be selfless. They must always put their people first. A fighter is never bored, lazy, weak, or a coward. There must always be a revolutionary task to take up. A ground force does not hold grudges because their mind is always focused on waging war against any reactionary element. A revolutionary fighter is a listener. They always understand the challenges of their communities. A fighter is not a complainer, but a solution provider for their communities. A fighter must be an all-rounder, a community activist, an agitator, an organizer, a defender of the revolution, the one who does not shake when confronted by the enemy. A fighter is the one who knows that in pursuit of our revolution, we do not care what the other section of society, that is pro-capitalism, thinks or feels about us. Now, fighters, commissars, let us prepare ourselves as we continue waging our war against imperialism, against capitalism, against racism, against liars, betrayers, and thieves, as it is the only way we can attain economic freedom in our lifetime. In closing, let me paraphrase Fanon. We, the oppressed people of Africa, have got nothing to lose but everything to gain. Thank you very much for engaging me as we're discussing the organizational character and the organizational redesign of the economic freedom fighters. Amandla. Yeah.